Greetings, everyone, and welcome to my review of the final issue of the Archie Mega Man series, hopefully for now. It's been a fun ride these past 55 issues. Well, technically 48, as 7 issues were part of crossovers with Sonic the Hedgehog, but it's not over yet. This review will be a bit different from what I usually do. If you've been watching my reviews for any length of time, you should know that I give a summary of the story, followed by my comments about the issue, which include any references to other media and such. I'm going to go ahead and say that there's not much story in this issue. I mean, there is a story, but it's not a typical story. You'll see as I go through this issue, so let's not waste any time. And what a perfect segue into the beginning as the Light family is helping out at the Kronos Institute. Mega Man and Time Man slow down the Time Skimmer so Dr. Light and Dr. Kuen can work on it. There's of course worry about time particles and other tachyon technobabble, and right on cue, Dr. Light gets zapped. As everyone tends to him, the catatonic Light starts seeing things. Flashman uses Time Stomp to help Dr. Light, and the paramedics arrive just as it wears off. Dr. Light's also coming around, claiming he saw visions and they're fading fast. But he's left with a sense of dread, which is quickly soothed with hope. So what exactly did Dr. Light see? 16 pages of pinups. I'm not joking. Each page at first is a representation of a classic Mega Man game that has not been adapted, and it features all the major players of that game. I'm not going to show each page in this review, because I want you to look at them for yourselves. I will, however, point out interesting things among the pinups. First of all, each of them have Dr. Light's commentary. Next is the order. After the Mega Man 4 pinup is this one depicting the Mega Man Game Boy games. Well, the first four at least, and Wily Tower. Which is a nice callback to the beginning of Mega Man 20, which had the Mega Man Killers and the Genesis unit at the same time. After the Mega Man 5 pinup, there's this nice one here depicting Mega Man V for the Game Boy, and it further emphasizes the connection between Ramune and the Star Droids. Next up is the Mega Man 6 pinup. There are two things I should note. One is this figure going through a portal. I think that's the Xander Payne Mr. X, and it might be the way Wily disposes of him. Because notice that the Mr. X in this pinup is a bit different than the Mr. X that we've been seeing in the comic, which means it's actually Wily in disguise. And the second thing is Plant Man. Remember, Plant Man has gotten to know Mega Man before this event, so seeing his face here just says, "I don't want to hurt you, but I must follow my Causing Mayhem program." So after pinups of Mega Man 7, 8, and Mega Man and Base, we have Mega Man 9. Dr. Light's commentary states that he recognizes all of the Robot Masters here. We know at this point that the only active Mega Man 9 Robot Masters are Concrete Man and Splash Woman. This line might imply that Light either built more, had plans to build more, or they're under construction. Possibly a combination of all three. And last but not least is Mega Man 10, with the Robo Enza plot. Before I continue, you may have noticed that the order of the pinups so far don't exactly match up to the time events depicted in Mega Man 20. For example, the events of the first four Mega Man Game Boy games and the Wily Wars have been moved to after the events of Mega Man 4 rather than before, and the notable absence of Rockman and Forte Challenger from the future. More than likely, there were changes that Ian had to do because Capcom. Though, I have a theory for what might have happened in-universe. Mega Man 20 took place before the events of Worlds Collide. This one took place after. When Mega Man restored his universe from the Super Genesis wave, not everything was the way it was before. Maybe it rearranged some events and made sure others don't come to pass. Of course, I could be pulling this out of my rear, but you never know. Anyway, let's continue with the pinups. So we go into the future of classic Mega Man, featuring this scene with Dr. Wily meeting an older version of himself. If you recall my Mega Man 20 review, I explained that Wily stole the Time Skimmer and traveled to the future where he recruited his future self and converted Mega Man into Quint. Well, this is that meeting, and here's the moment where Mega Man gets transformed into Quint. Finally, on the bottom of this page, we have Dr. Light sealing his greatest creation, X, and Dr. Wily sealing his greatest creation, Zero. It's a perfect segue to the pinup of the Mega Man X series. From this point onward, each pinup will represent a game series. And since I've talked a lot about the X series in past reviews, I won't spend much time here. I will briefly point out the new people in this shot. The purple-haired girl is Lair, and she is Zero's navigator for the Maverick Hunters. This girl with the strange hairdo is Palette, and she is Axel's navigator for the Maverick Hunters. Both appeared in Mega Man X8. The guy above Palette is Douglas, and he's the engineer/mechanic for the Maverick Hunters. He's appeared in Mega Man X5 and X6. The Reploid above Lair is known as Lifesaver, the medical control officer of the Maverick Hunters. He's only appeared in Mega Man X5. The next pinup is not necessarily a game, but an event that bridges the X series and the next series coming up, the Elf Wars. This event marked the end of the Maverick Wars in one of the most bloodiest conflicts ever. A human scientist named Dr. Wheel or Wile, however you pronounce that name, corrupted a sentient computer program called the Mother Elf and made baby copies of it. By the way, the Mother Elf's ultimately the cure for the Sigma virus. Just thought I'd point that out. Anyway, the copies then took control of the Reploids. I'm going to call him Wheel, wanted to combine the re-christened Dark Elf with Omega. No, not that Omega. Ah, there we go. This giant Reploid right here, to control all the Reploids. But X and Zero stopped him. Now speaking of Cyber Elves, take a look at this one right here. Looks familiar, doesn't it? Could this be that Light himself evolved into a sentient program? Well, Mega Man X5 does hint at this. Anyway, this leads to the aftermath and the next pinup, the representation of the Mega Man Zero series. Set 100 years after the X series, it follows Zero, after being revived thanks to a cyber elf, joining a resistance against the forces of Neo Arcadia, the last functional city ruled by a copy of X. The real X did rule the city, but he eventually ascended and became a cyber elf himself. A copy was created by this person, Dr. Seal. She later regretted it when Copy X began oppressing and executing Reploids to solve Neo Arcadia's power problems. She went with the Reploid refugees to a ruined city and formed the Resistance. Some notable Resistance members that appear in this pinup include Servo, the engineer responsible for Zero's weapons, Rouge and Jean, the operators of the Resistance base, Andrew, an old Reploid who talks a lot, Alouette, a child Reploid that treasures a doll Seal gave her and looks up to Seal. And finally, Hybo, a Reploid that eats a lot of energy crystals. The group on top are the antagonists for most of the Zero series, Copy X and the Four Guardians. From left to right, we have Sage Harpooya, Fairy Leviathan, Copy X in his powered up form, Fighting Fafnir, and Hidden Phantom. Behind Copy X is the real X as a cyber elf. The two in the middle from the left to right are Neige and Kraft, and they appeared in Mega Man Zero 4. I'm suddenly reminded of Neige, or someone that looked like hers, appearance from way back in the first issue. Kinda makes this all bookend. Anyway, to set up the next pinup, I'm going to spoil the ending to Zero 4, the last game of the Mega Man Zero series. Dr. Wheel, that same guy, has returned and has taken over Neo Arcadia. His policies were so extreme that if you don't like it, you will be labeled a Maverick and imprisoned and or die, regardless if you're a human or a Reploid. Many humans fled Neo Arcadia to find refuge in a place called Area Zero. Said area is actually the crash site of the space colony Eurasia. And that happened during the events of Mega Man X5. Speaking of orbiting space objects, Dr. Wheel planned on using an orbiting weapon called Ragnarok to destroy Area Zero and any other possible refugee spot except for Neo Arcadia. Kraft, who was working for Dr. Wheel, had enough of the guy and used Ragnarok on Neo Arcadia, which left a giant hole in the city and killed 20 million people, just for a chance to kill Dr. Wheel. Dr. Wheel survived and decided to drop Ragnarok on Area Zero. Zero defeats him and stopped Ragnarok, but at the cost of his life. This act here helped brought about true peace between humans and Reploids. Ironic that a robot built by Dr. Wily to be a killing machine caused world peace. Part of the peace included Reploids gaining life expectancies and humans getting mechanical parts, effectively making them both one and the same, though Reploids have red triangles on their foreheads. And so the stage was set for the next game series, Mega Man ZX. Set about 200 years after the Zero series, these two games, Mega Man ZX and ZX Advent, deal with conflicts of this new world, ranging from Mavericks, though in this case are those who refuse to conform to the Human Reploid Equalization Law, corporations, in particular Slither Inc., and finally elements of the government itself. The heroes and villains use biometals, substances that store the data of a human or Reploid, and mega-merge with a person so said person can use their powers. On the bottom left are the heroes of the first game, Vent and Ailey, and on the bottom right are the main characters for the sequel, Gray and Ash. In the games themselves, you have to choose who you're going to play as, but I guess here they're combining their stories, though Vent and Ailey's are more or less the same. Above Vent and Ailey is Giro, owner of the shipping company Giro Express, which transports anything, as well as take care of children who lost their families in Maverick outbreaks. Vent and Ailey were his responsibility. Above Gray and Ash is Prairie, who is the leader of the Guardians, an organization that helps people against Mavericks. Prairie is supposed to be a character from the previous series, and it's been more or less confirmed. Remember the little Reploid girl Alouette? Yeah, she grows up to be Prairie. Clue number one, the doll Prairie has. It's identical, if not the same, as Alouette's. And two, she became the leader of the Guardians after the original leader and founder, her big sister, disappeared. Based on what I looked up, the founder of the Guardians was Dr. Seal, the person Alouette looked up to. The people above Giro and Prairie are Prometheus and Pandora. They were created by a member of the ruling body to get a certain biometal for ultimate power or something like that. And the three people on top are the ruling body. From left to right, we have Master Albert, Master Thomas, and Master Mikhail. Named after Albert Wily, Thomas Light, and Mikhail Cossack, respectively. I should point out that Master Albert built Prometheus and Pandora. Yeah. Finally, we have the biometals themselves. As stated earlier, they have the data of the being it's based on. That is, personality and DNA. So, going from top to bottom, we have Model X, which is based on X, Model Z, which is based on Zero, then we have Model A, which was created by Master Albert as a backup system, Model H, which is based on Harpuya, Model L is based on Leviathan, Model F is based on Fifnir, Model P is based on Phantom, and finally, Model W, which is based on Dr. Wheel and the biometal the antagonist in the games want. Boy, I've been explaining a lot about these past few series. Well, we have one more game pinup, and it's a representation of Mega Man Legends. Set several thousand years after the ZX series, the world's covered mostly by ocean, and humans as we know them have died off and were replaced by the artificial humans known as Carbons. Mega Man Legends is the story of Mega Man Volnut, his partner Roll Casket, her grandfather Barrel Casket, and Data the Robot Monkey traveling the world and digging for quantum refractors, their civilization's power source. They would occasionally get into conflicts with Reaver Bots and Air Pirates. The most prominent Air Pirates are the Bonds. They're led by Teasel, with his sister Tron as the tech inventor, and their little brother Bon, who's the big guy. They have little servant bots called, Serve Bots, that were built by Tron. That was the last vision Dr. Light has, and of course he'll forget everything. If he retained knowledge of, say, the Maverick Wars, he might have second thoughts about building X. Our final page of this issue, and possibly this series, is a cast shot, essentially giving everyone their final farewells with Dr. Light believing that there will always be hope and a Mega Man to protect us. Originally, there wasn't going to be the Dr. Light frame story, but Capcom wanted something of a structure. Otherwise, it would have been pinups and two-page spreads of the games. Ryan Jampol really has come a long way since he debuted in issue 19, And now you know why I re-uploaded that issue's review along with issue 20's. Similar to my re-uploaded version of my issue 20 review, I am not giving a score for this issue. Now, I don't hate this issue. Again, the art's great, but it feels different than the others. Probably because it's wrapping things up. And so, folks, the Mega Man comic, according to Archie, is on hiatus. But realistically, I think it's done. There are interviews online featuring Ian Flynn, the writer, and the current editor, Vincent, talking about stories they wish they could have told. And that subscribers, myself included, have gotten this letter saying that it's the last issue and all remaining subscriptions will be transferred to Sonic Universe. Now, I could be wrong and the comic could return one day. If that happens, I see the following possibilities. 1. It'll continue from where it left off with the Mega Man 4 adaption. 2. We jump ahead sometime after Mega Man 10 and tell new original stories with references to past games, kind of like the current Sonic comics. 3. An anthology series a la Sonic Universe where it tells a story arc with, say, classic Mega Man. Then the next arc would be characters from, say, the ZX series, though this option might be confusing to people. And 4. A reboot, possibly related to the planned 2017 Mega Man series. I know it's a long shot, but if you want the Mega Man comic to come back, convince Archie that this is a series worthy to be printed. Buy whatever issues and trades that are available. If you know people who like Mega Man but they never read the comic, introduce it to them. If it's not their thing, that's fine. Don't force it down their throats. Write to Archie and explain why Mega Man must continue. And please be civil. No letters like, "You suck, Archie, I hope you go bankrupt." Whether or not this works, I really am going to miss this series. It's a nice, albeit at times repetitive, deconstruction of the games. Well, the ones that were adapted anyway. It explored relationships between creation and maker, and it had compelling character moments, and overall generally good art. So thank you, Ian Flynn, for writing this comic, Aaliyah Baker for designing characters like Quake Woman, and the various artists including Spaz, Powry, and Ryan Jampol. I am going to privately mourn the loss of this series by turning on my 3DS and marathoning Mega Man's 4 through 6 and Mega Man B for the Game Boy. Review-wise, I will eventually have all of my old reviews re-uploaded to this channel. As for new content, there are mangas I could look at, but I have something else planned for next year. Here's a sneak peek. Fighting robot!